Brothers and sisters, I greet you in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ and extend a hearty welcome to all of you joining us for worship today, Sunday, 23rd of January, 2022. We are happy to have you join us. Congratulations! Happy birthday! Happy anniversary to all those celebrating this week. May God richly bless you. A special happy birthday to one of our local preachers, Brother Mervyn Ragunanan. Wish you all the best for your birthday.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, happy birthday, happy birthday to you.
If you are grieving the loss of a loved one, may the constant love of friends and the family soften your sadness. May the cherished memories bring you moments of comfort, and may the lasting peace surround your heart. We offer sincere condolences to anyone who is grieving or going through a difficult period. May the faithful Lord our God bless and comfort you at this time. Our weekly Wednesday midday service continues this Wednesday, January 26, from 12 p.m. to 1 p.m. at the Castries Chapel, and will be conducted by Rev'd Anyad within the confinements of the COVID-19 protocols. Kindly note that our circuit fasting is from 6 a.m. to 1 p.m. and we are encouraged every Wednesday to observe this as much as we are able. Let us humble ourselves before God as we earnestly seek Him. Circuit Bible study will be held via Zoom on Wednesday, 26 January at 7 p.m., where we will continue looking at the topic Confirmation in the Biblical Perspective. We invite you to make every effort to attend as we deepen our spirituality. We are encouraged to remain committed to our financial support of God's work through the Church. Your tithes, offerings and donations can be deposited to the Republic Bank, St. Lucia, the account number 950-1000-59919. We thank you for your faithful giving. We do appreciate the efforts of everyone who has contributed to the successful outcome of our worship experience today. May God bless you and yours. Our preacher for today is Rev'd Nuku Smith. We await the word that the Holy Spirit has placed on his heart and pray God's continued blessings upon him and his wife. And our thought for the week, Luke chapter 18, verse 27. What is impossible with man is possible for God. Let us now ready ourselves for worship.
Good morning, my brothers and sisters, and welcome to this morning's act of worship. I bring you greetings from the Methodist Church, St. Lucia Circuit. We are happy to be coming into your homes this morning, and we sincerely hope that our service this morning will be of a blessing and inspiration to you. Let us go to our call to worship. This day is holy to our God. Do not mourn or weep. The Spirit of the Holy One is upon us to bring good news to the poor. This day is holy to our God, for the joy of the Holy One is our strength. God sends us to proclaim release to the captives, recover the sight to the blind, and justice to the oppressed. On this day, may the scripture be fulfilled in our hearing. May the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts be pleasant to you, Holy One, our Rock and our Redeemer. We continue our act of worship by singing hymn 399 in the VIP, 399, Great is our Redeeming Lord.
Invited to go to God in prayer, in our prayer of adoration, confession, and thanksgiving. Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, we praise and adore you for empowering us to claim membership of the body of Christ, a gift received through the fullness of your grace. Empower us anew, we pray, with tongues of fire and hearts of love, to proclaim the reconciling word among people. Remind us that we are all members of one body, and if one member suffer, we all suffer. May we, as the body of Christ in this place, in this moment, in this community, be the best evidence of your love by declaring and witnessing to this as the year of the Lord's favor for all people. We give thanks that all of us are Christ's body and rejoice in each one being as part of it. Accept our adoration and praise for these great gifts, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Our prayer of confession. invite us to respond appropriately. Rock and Redeemer, you call us to remember that we are all members of one body in your Spirit. Forgive us when we do not embody your love, when we speak harshly to one another, and when we judge others in our hearts. Together, we drink of one Spirit and share in the same love that makes us one. Reclaim us when we refuse to hear your word, when spoken by those who do not look or sound as we expect. Remind us that when one of your creatures suffer, all of creation suffers. Renew us when we forget that we are one body, one family of our heavenly Creator. The assurance of pardon. Hear the good news. God heals our illusions of separateness and make us one and whole. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Continue in the spirit of prayer as we give thanks to God. Gracious and everlasting Father, we give you thanks for life. We give you thanks for what you have made available through your graces. We give you thanks for the redemptive and atoning work of your Son, Jesus Christ. We give you thanks for all of creation. We give you thanks that we are forgiven because of Jesus. We give you thanks for the community of faith. We give you thanks for the gifts and privileges that you have extended and afforded us, that as we gather as your people through technology in our own different spaces, we give you thanks for the unity that your word and spirit gathers us to worship you in spirit and in truth. We continue to give thanks, knowing that our lives is indebted to you. We pray because we love you, only because you first loved us. This is the prayer of adoration, of confession, and thanksgiving, offered in no other name, but in the mighty name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. We now continue as we minister to our children today with the theme, Keep Focused, focused on the Bible reading of 1 Timothy 6:12, Fight the Good Fight of Faith and Holding On to Eternal Life. There was a bench of army cadets under a general who usually instruct them in how to uniformly able to march together. And he reminded them that they must have a place of focus, the horizon, in which they must gaze constantly upon, and also pay attention to his command. Their eyes and their ears must stay focused. So they must focus at the horizon and very much attentive with their ears to the command. And as they begin the drill of marching, the uniformity depend on how well they were focused with their eyes on the horizon and how well they were attentive, their ears were attentive to the commands that were given. There will be many distractions, yet when they're focused, it's on a place of the horizon, their ears were attentive, they were able in unison, much in unity. And destruction at times were greater, but when they had their eyes on where they're supposed to focus, and they were attentive enough, they were able to be in line with all that was required of them. This story reminds us an encouragement to you, our children, today. I know that there are many distractions in your lives. Some of us has begun face-to-face, and they have to go back into online learning. Some of us has just begun with our preparation after coming back from the breaks, and there is so many disturbances to our learning. To you, our children, stay focused on what you want to accomplish in life. And stay attentive to those who love you and encourage you. And especially in your life of faith, stay focused on Jesus. The distractions will not alter where you are going and what you want to achieve if you stay focused in life. Like our spiritual journey, when we keep on the fight, stay focused, hold fast to the faith, we're able to achieve what we are going towards. Distractions will always happen. Sometimes the noise can be louder. Sometimes things cross our path. But when we keep focus, we never lose sight of what we are supposed to achieve and accomplish. So I encourage you, pray that God will help you to have a focused life, a focused mindset, a focused attitude, that you will be attentive to what is important. And I pray as you continue in this time of so much challenges and difficulties and distractions, that the words of God, the word of God, and also the words of our teachers and parents will help us and keep us focused in what we are supposed to achieve. It is my prayer, as we continue on in this year of 2022, we will keep focused, and God will help us keep focused, and we will be able to achieve what we are to accomplish in this year. In the name of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I invite you in wherever you are, just to close your eyes as I pray over you, as I pray for a focused life in your life for the year that is before you. Let us pray. Dear God Almighty, bless the life of our children and our youths. In this time of children and youth, we pray, O God, that they will keep on with a focused life, that enable them to be attentive to what is important, not to be distracted easily. We know that a lot of disturbance has occurred in these past 2 years, changes and transitions of their life, face-to-face learning to online learning to face-to-face, the different environments that has been provided for them for learning experiences. But we pray that you will help and encourage them and strengthen them for a focused life. Steady their eyesight to gaze at what is important. Strengthen their inner ability to listen and be attentive and have a teachable heart to learn. We pray these blessings and ask these mercies. May anointing befall them through the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray in the name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Amen. I continue to use to encourage you and bless you and wish well to all our children this morning and our youths in your school life and in your education. Amen. As we continue in worship, I invite us to sing to the glory of God, hymn 391, Christ from whom all blessings flow, followed by the ministry of the word. continue in the ministry of the word, I invite us to pray together the collect. God of heaven, you send the gospel to the ends of the earth and your messengers to every nation. Send your Holy Spirit to transform us by the good news of everlasting life in Christ, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our first reading comes to us from the book of Nehemiah, Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 1 to 10. It reads, "All the people gathered together into the square before the water gate. They told the scribes, Ezra, to bring the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had given to Israel. Accordingly, the priest Ezra brought the law before the assembly, both men and women, and all who heard with understanding. This was on the first day of the seventh month. He read from it, facing the square before the water gate, from early morning until midday, in the presence of men and women, and those who could understand, and the ears of all the people were attentive to the book of the law. The scribe Ezra stood on the wooden platform that had been made for the purpose. Beside him stood Matthias, Shema, Ananiah, Uriah, Hilkiah, and Maaseiah. On his right hand, Pedaiah, Mishael, Malchishah, and Hashem, Hashbadanai, Zechariah, and Mesullam on his left hand. And Ezra opened the book in the sight of all the people, for he was standing above all the people. And when he opened it, and all the people stood up, then Ezra blessed the Lord, the great God, and all the people answered, Amen, Amen, lifting up their hands. Then they bowed their heads and worshiped the Lord with their face to the ground. Also Jeshua, Bani, Sherebiah, Jamin, Akbar, Shabbathiah, Hedoiah, Maaseiah, Kalita, Ashariah, Jobad, Hanan, Pelaiah, and Levites helped the people to understand the law while the people remained in their place. So they read from the book from the law of God with the interpretation. They gave the sense so that the people understood the reading. And Nehemiah, who was the governor, and Ezra, the priest and the scribe, and the Levites who taught the people, said to all the people, This day is holy to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep. For all the people wept when they heard the words of the law. Then he said to them, Go your way, eat the fat, and drink sweet wine, and send portions of them to those for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy to our Lord, and do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. The word of the Lord. The reading comes to us, the epistle readings from 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12 to 31.
For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit, we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear would say, Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would make it any less a part of the body. And if the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole body were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? And if it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many members, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need for you. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need for you. On the contrary, the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And those members of the body that we respect, whereas our respectable members do not need this. But God has arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member, that there be one dissension within the body, but the members may have the same care of one another. If one member suffers, all suffer together with it. If one member is honored, all rejoice together with it. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then deeds of power, then gifts of healing, forms of assistance, forms of leadership, various kinds of tongues. All are apostles, all are prophets, all are teachers. Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? But strive for the greater gifts, and I will show you a still more excellent way. My brothers and sisters, this is the word of the Lord. We continue our worship service by singing hymn 402 in the VIP. All praise to our redeeming Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Let us turn our attention to the gospel reading which comes to us from Luke chapter 4, verse 14 to 21. Glory to you, O Lord. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in the synagogue and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "To this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." The gospel of Christ. Praise be to Christ our Lord. I invite us to attentively open our hearts as we hear the proclaimed word. Let us come to God in prayer. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable to you, O Lord, our great Redeemer. Speak, we are listening. We pray in the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Today I invite us to reflect on the theme of celebrating God's abundance in our unity. Celebrating God's abundance in our unity. The Old Testament reading is a reminder of a nation that was rebuilding after exile. Nehemiah and Ezra had returned to Judah after a lapse of years, finding the place ruined and the need for rebuilding the city walls and the city itself. But they saw that the rebuilding of the city walls and defenses were not only the need in light of the rebuilding of this nation. At the heart of this rebuilding is the realization that there must be also a spiritual renewal in the life of the community. Writing in that same century of Nehemiah was a Greek historian who said that the point that it is the people and not the wall that makes a city. That it is not only important to rebuild the wall, but also to rebuild the lives of people, including their spirituality. The spiritual, the moral, and the social contribution of committed men and women is of great importance than just the physical structure in a community. This is a reminder to us in a time when we think that all has crumbled in our community economically, and we're in a state of rebuilding as we go through or living through a pandemic, trying to gather together lives. And this story reminds us, as Nehemiah gathered the people to center their life in the Word of God, to celebrate God's abundance in a time when they thought there was scarcity and limitations, that the word of Nehemiah to them, "Eat, drink, have joy, for the joy of the Lord is our strength." But all of this unfolds in the context of valuing God's word as a vital component to the rebuilding of the spiritual, moral, and social life of the people of Judah. And it is also a reminder to us in a time when we are trying to gather ourselves, gather our sense of identity, gather a sense of life and livelihood, that it is not just important for us as a people to think about the economics of life, to think about the physicality of life, but foremost is our unity that is derived from our spirituality that only the Word of God can be able to accomplish. There are things in life, brothers and sisters, that only our spiritual life, centered in the Word of God, can accomplish. And it is important that Nehemiah and the story of Nehemiah chapter 8, as the book of 1 Corinthians also affirms, is the unity that comes only through the valuing of God's word. This is a reminder to us in a time and a season when our lives can be so indifferent to the word of God, that there are so many things that we place as priority more than we place at the heart of our life and our living is the living word flowing, transforming, renewing, building up a people, a spiritual people that brings life into a community. I invite us to reflect on the text of Nehemiah to learn how God's people valued the word in this story and how it instructs us now as we look to a time of rebuilding. And as we value the word in our lives and in our community as essential, fundamental, important to the rebuilding of the ruins of a pandemic, the ruins of a community that we are called, that there is only one thing can bring about life, the life of the church, in life of the community in the world, that is only the word of God. Few points that this scripture highlights. The first is that the people were single-minded when it came to the word of God. Nehemiah chapter 8 verse 1 reminds us that all the people gathered together in the square to listen to the word. In fact, they gathered together and say, bring out the word, let it be read in our presence. They single-mindedly made this resolution and this commitment that they must listen to the word of God. They assembled in the different diversities of their life. They had individual likes and dislikes. They had preferences. They differ in so many ways, and some of them would have been exiled. There were those who remained in Jerusalem. But despite their differences, something that they were sure and single-minded about is the need and value of God's word in rebuilding of a people, of a nation. We may have different likes and preferences in all sorts of our life in our community. We may have different preferences when it comes to our pattern of worship, to the concepts of the church, to the work of the Spirit, but something that we must celebrate in light of God's abundance, in the light of our unity, that we must single-mindedly affirm
that our community can only be rebuilt, only be revitalized, only be renewed and transformed if is at the center of it the Word of God. The Word of God to constitute founder in the community is deeply founded and directed by the Word and Word alone. We may differ in so many aspects of life, but we must be open to a truth, and an important and vital truth, with single-minded, united, that Scripture is at the basis of our spiritual revival. Scripture, it is the basis of our deepest desire and human need right now for the rebuilding of nations, of lives, of family. And this must be important in our lives. We must faithfully and reveally, with one mind, as God's people, the unifying form within our life, the place of Scripture in our lives, must be valued here and now. I call on us, in our community here and now and in this time, and the need to reset, in a need to rebuild, in a need to bring life in our church, in our community, and the nation as a whole. We may have different opinions, but something that we must have with one single mind in order to rebuild, at the center of rebuilding, is the Word that directs, informs our spirituality, our lives, socially, communally, and morally. I call on of us now, here and now, with one mind, let us value the Word in our midst. With our one mind, we must unify and united to resolve the need of God's Word here and now. How many times do we read God's Word? How many times are we committed to avail ourselves to the instruction of God's Word, to the direction of God's Word, for us to truly see the extent and the fullness of rebuilding, of restoration? We must, with one single mind, resolve of the importance of God's Word in our lives and in our community. A second point, what we see in this story is the people were enthusiastic about the Word. The most remarkable feature that this story reminds us that there was a demand for Scripture by the people. They told Ezra, the scribe, to bring out the book of the law. They craved for God's Word. They were hungry for the spiritual food, the biblical truth. We have so many needs and thoughts that we need in our lives. But we need the renewal of our enthusiasm for the Word, our hunger and craving for the Word. Some of us have so many pursuits in life, pursuits for greater wealth, pursuits for greater knowledge. But a nation that is stronger, a nation that is transformed, a community that lives through and gather itself up and rise from the ruins, is a people who is enthusiastic about God's Word to guide and to inform. The psalmist usually portrays this enthusiasm in Scripture by saying, your word is sweeter than honey. Your word is a lamp to thy feet. Your word is joy to our heart. Your word is more valuable than gold. It's a reminder of that deeper craving of God's people to the Word of God that is at the heart of rebuilding, of restoring, of resetting. A third lesson that we could learn from the life of the people of Israel as they valued the word was not only they had single mind about the word, it's not only that they have enthusiasm about the word, they also have this attentiveness to the word of God. Once they came together, nothing was going to distract them from immersing themselves in this blessing to receive the word of God and fix their eyes on what the word was going to deliberate to them. It is important in the business of our lives and our pursuit of our livelihoods that we must see the importance of our attentiveness to the word of God. How many times do you sit down and sit back in the business of your life to immerse yourself attending to what God's word says and speaks to you? A problem in our life and our journey could be we are just listening yet not attentive enough to study God's word. We are at the expense of how the world uses us, that we have not availed ourselves and our attention to the word that brings life here and now. To rebuild a nation needs a people who are attentive to God's word, attend to study God's word, attend to listening to God's word, attend to understanding God's word to the extent that their attentiveness to God's word, that the word affects them, reforms them, transforms them, reset their lives, and allow their will to come in line with the will of God. Our mind, human mind, is a wandering mind. And it only takes the word of God to settle in one's mind and thoughts that it informs and directs us. And something profound about the nation of Judah as it was rebuilt by Nehemiah, by Ezra, that at the heart was a people who were attentive to God's word. A fourth point today, that the people were responsive and submissive to the word of God. They said, "Amen, amen." They lifted up their hands and also they bowed down, surrendering themselves in submission to the word of God. A call today to rebuild our community, to rebuild our nation, is a call to respond and submit ourselves to the word. The word and promises of God will never fail. The word of human comes and goes, but God is our dwelling place for all generation. The people of Judah knew that words of king fail, words of prophets that were not anointed by God failed, words of men failed. But when the words was read once more in their hearing, and as they were helped to understand, the people valued the word, that they responded and submitted themselves wholly to the word. A call to us this morning, brothers and sisters, in this time and this season, in order for us to grow, in order for us to celebrate God's abundance in the unity that the Spirit and the Word brings, we must willingly respond and submit our lives to the Word of God here and now. People honored the uniqueness of God's Word in this story. And they submitly, not solely because the Lord is its unique source, but because the word of God has brought life in the past And God's faithfulness on his life, on his word, has never failed. We can rest assured in our life, here and now, that God's promises will never fail you, nor fail me. Our last and final point today, the people were teachable. They valued God's word not only with single-mindedness, not only with their attentiveness, not only with their enthusiasm, not only with their response and submissiveness to the word, but also their openness to be taught to learn from it. We have a tendency now to listen, yet not allow ourselves to be taught. We allow ourselves to hear, yet do not avail ourselves to the extent that we allow the word to alter, to change, to transform, to renew. That is why at times we choose the preacher we listen to, because as long as it is in line with what we want to hear, it's okay with us. Brothers and sisters, in order for us to grow, in order for us to be renewed, in order for us to reset, then we must have a teachable heart to allow the word to affect us, to allow the word to transform us. But here in this story, there were the leaders who made the word so available to the people in a way that they understood it in its basics, that they were able to learn, that they were able to receive as they were taught. If there is something that is needed in this time and in this season to rebuild lives, to rebuild spirituality, to rebuild community, to rebuild nation, it's for us as a people to be, to have a teachable spirit, to allow ourselves to be taught and be led by the word of God. This is the call that we are called here and now. And as the story of Nehemiah ended, as the people submit themselves and learned of scripture and were taught of scripture, they were mourning. Then came the word of Nehemiah: stop mourning. Stop lamenting. This is the day that the Lord has made. Celebrate. Go. Because the word has rebuilt, the word has renewed, the word has brought life. And when we as God's people here and now, in a time of scarcity and limitation, in a time that we have mourning, complaining for 2 years within a pandemic, when at the center of our lives is the word of God, at the center of our lives is the celebration of that abundance and that unity which the word brings, and it rebuilds our spirituality, our morality, our social life, that it's founded and deeply rooted in the will and word of God, that we can boldly say, the joy of the Lord is my strength. In all that we may be facing and all that we may encounter, that as the word is at the center of our lives, with single-mindedness, the people who are called Methodists, the people who are called Christians, single-mindedly we avail ourselves to the word, we attend to the word, we with enthusiasm continue to strive and hunger and crave for the word, and we respond and submit to the word to the extent that we learn and allow the word in a teachable heart to receive and practice and live by the word, we will see God's abundance in our journey as God's people. And we can celebrate with joy, united in God's presence. As we continue striving, rebuilding, this story reminds us at the heart of rebuilding a nation is spiritual
revival. And at the heart of spiritual revival is the Word of God. And at the heart of the Word of God is a people who is willing to receive and allow the Word to be part of their lives. I hope and pray that we will have as part of our lives a celebration of God's abundance in unity in light of God's Word. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. As we respond to God's Word and meditate on God's Word, I invite us to sing prayerfully hymn 255, Blessed Be the Tie That Binds. Let us sing to the glory of God. Us to a time of intercession as we pray and intercede for others. Let us pray. Almighty God, who answers prayers, who attend to our need as we pray according to your will for the concerns of others, we bring to you in this time and in this season the need for spiritual revival, the need to connect to your Word and connect to your mission in the world. As you are already at work in the lives of your people, but we pray that with oneness and unity, that we can feast and enjoy the power of your Word as it teaches us, as it binds us together, and as it directs our lives for the betterment of our life, that we may live to what you want of us. At national level and throughout the world, at global level, in our small societies, at the different aspects of our lives, we pray that your Word will reign supreme and your will be done. We pray, O God, and bring to you the need of unity in the need and craving for your Word. We may be indifferent to so many things, and we pray, O God, that we will be humble enough to submit ourselves, teachable, available, to the direction of your word and your spirit. We bring to you those who are in need in this time. We bring to you for world peace, and those who pursue war, those who pursue greed and wealth in our world today. We pray to you for the situation in Ukraine, between the bigger nations of the world. The world is on the brink of war. We pray that you will move hearts to the consequences that it can bring to the lives of people when we do not learn to live with each other, respecting each other's boundaries and lives. We pray of sense, of love, of peace to prevail. We also bring to you at this time in the island kingdom of Tonga, for them going through a volcanic eruption and also the effects of a tsunami. We uplift, O God, of their livelihoods, of the devastation that he has caused, loss of life, loss of livelihoods. We pray, O God, as we stand with them and embrace and uplift their needs. We thank you, O God, for those who have made available resources that they are able to rebuild, to attend to their needs at this time. We also bring to you, in our context in the Caribbean, the rebuilding of lives after the eruption of suffering St. Vincent, and those who have undergone the destruction of destructive forces of nature through hurricane. And we pray, O God, the rebuilding. And also, God, the ruins of a pandemic, the devastated nation, families, and communities. Those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. Those who are unable to grieve in a healthy way. We uplift their lives before you. We pray, O God, of the rebuilding of our island nation of St. Lucia. We pray of government. We pray of non-government organizations. We pray, O God, of the communities that are part of our national building. And we pray, O God, of the community of faith, that we, with single-minded, will see the value of your word for the spiritual building, for the moral building, for the social building of this nation. We plea and intercede in the name of Jesus, that healing, reconciliation shall come about and unity shall come about in the light of your word as it restores, renews, and rebuilds. We pray of people who are called Methodists, Christians. We pray that we'll continue to unify and celebrate the abundance of your word, your abundance, O God, and unify under that abundance in light of your word, that your joy shall be our strength. This is a prayer of intercession. We bring to you our needs and our concern. As you invite us, come all who are weary and heavy laden, and we pray that we will find our rest in you. We pray in the name of Jesus, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As our service come to an end, I invite us to sing to the glory of God, hymn 389, Savior, Blessed Savior, while we sing.
Savior, Blessed Savior, listen. even while we sing, hearts and voices raising praises to our King. All we have we offer, all we hope to be, body, soul, and spirit, all we yield to Thee. Nearer, ever nearer, Christ, we draw to Thee. Deep in adoration, bending low the on earth to die, now that we might follow, hast gone up on high. Clearer still and clearer dawns the light from heaven, in our sadness bringing of sin forgive. Life has lost its shadows, pure the light within. Thou hast shed Thy radiance on our world of sin. Onward, ever saints before us, journeying on to God, leaving all behind us, may we hasten on, backward never looking, till the prize is won.
Receive the benediction. As living members of the holy body of Christ, may we see the face of the Holy One in everyone we meet, and may we hear God's holy word in every sound and voice we hear. Go in the peace to love and save the world. God's abundance in unity, as we are united, resolved to live by God's word to the rebuilding of our lives and our spirituality. Amen. And now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of us, now and forevermore. Amen.